there are multiple sizes of infinity. In fact, there are infinitely many sizes of infinity. Let's explore this idea in five levels, starting from tangible examples from hotel infinity to some of the most amazing math proofs of all time. For level one, let's start with the natural numbers, 1, 2, and so on. And let's imagine a hotel infinity that has one room for each natural number. So the number one stays in room one, number two stays in room two, and so on. Now say that the number zero arrives. All of the rooms in the hotel are full, but can we accommodate this extra guest? Well, we'll have to move the guests around a bit. Let's tell every guest to move down one room. Number one will stay in room two, two will stay in room three, and so on. Every natural number still has a room, n is staying in room n plus one, but now room number one is empty, so we can have zero stay there. So what just happened? We've shown that the natural numbers starting with 1 take up exactly the same number of rooms as the whole numbers starting with 0. So we say that these two sets of numbers have the same cardinality. This is a way of measuring the size of the set. Although the second set includes the number 0, both sets fit in exactly the same number of rooms. Another way to explain this is to say that there's a bijection between these two sets. This means that there's a way to pair off the values in each set so that every number in each set is paired with exactly one number from the other set. The natural numbers have the same cardinality whether or not we include zero. For level two, let's see what happens when all the integers show up to the hotel. Guests 0, 1, 2, and so on all have rooms. But now we need rooms for all of the negative integers. There's infinitely many guests who now want rooms. Can we accommodate all of them? You can pause here if you want to think about it. Here's one way to accommodate all of the guests. Let's tell all the current guests to spread out so that they use only the odd-numbered rooms. 0 can stay in room 1, 1 can stay in room 3, and 2 can stay in room 5, and so on. All of the current guests will still have a room. Number n is now staying in room 2n plus 1, but now we have infinitely many free rooms. We can have the negative integers stay in those even rooms. Negative 1 can be assigned to room 2, negative 2 can be assigned to room 4, and so on. And now all of the integers are accommodated in hotel infinity. We've shown that the integers and the non-negative integers have the same cardinality. For level 3, let's consider the rational numbers. Let's try to fit every rational number in hotel infinity. Which rational number should be first or second? To make things a bit easier to start with, let's think about the positive rationals. Let's create this grid. In the upper left corner, we can put the fraction 1 over 1, and then as we move from left to right, we'll increase the numerator by 1. And then as we move from top to bottom, we'll increase the denominator by 1. Every positive fraction is in this grid somewhere. Now, it's worth pointing out that the values are frequently repeated. Like the number 1 is 1 over 1, but it's also 2 over 2, 3 over 3, and so on. But every positive fraction does show up in the grid. So now let's assign rooms. Let's say 1 over 1 gets to be in room number 1, and then 2 over 1 will be in room number 2. Now we move diagonally to assign 1 half to be in room number 3, and we keep zigzagging through the fractions like this. When we get to 2 over 2, since that's the same as 1 over 1, which already has a room, we'll just skip it. Every positive fraction will be assigned a room in the hotel. So we've shown that the positive fractions have the same cardinality as the natural numbers. We often call this size of infinity countable. We were able to count the positive fractions one by one and get a complete list of all of them in order. Now, what happens if we want to include all the rationals, including zero and the negative fractions? We can do exactly what we did before. We have the non-negative fractions stay in the odd-numbered rooms, and the negative fractions can stay in the even-numbered rooms. Again, we're able to show that the fractions are countable. They have the same cardinality as the integers. For level 4, let's finally talk about a set with a larger cardinality, the real numbers. If all the real numbers show up at Hotel Infinity, we're going to run out of rooms. To keep things simple, let's try to assign rooms to all of the real numbers between 0 and 1, and then we'll see why this isn't possible. This is called Cantor's diagonal argument, which Cantor published in 1891. The proof is by contradiction. This means we're going to assume that we can list all the real numbers between 0 and 1, and then we'll show that we've created a logical contradiction. We're assuming we can make a list of all the real numbers with their room assignments, so let's write down that list. Maybe the first room is assigned to the real number 0.5, and maybe the second room is assigned to the square root of 2 divided by 2, which is this value, and so on. Now, did we forget any values? Well, if you want to add one or two to the list, you can definitely do that now. But at some point, we're going to have a perfect list. That's what we're assuming for contradiction. Let's look at the diagonal. We're trying to reach a contradiction, so let's try to find a real number between 0 and 1 that is missing from our list. Let's pick the first digit of our number to be contrary to the first digit of the first number in the list. That digit is a 5, so let's pick something other than 5. How about 0? For the second digit, let's look at the diagonal value of the second number in the list. That value is 0, and we want to create a new number, so let's pick something other than 0, maybe 1. We'll continue this procedure to construct each digit in our diagonal number. This diagonal number is a real number between 0 and 1, so it's supposed to be in our perfect list. But which one is it? It can't equal the first number because they have different first digits. And it can't equal the second number because they have different second digits. In fact, the diagonal number that we created can't be in the list at all. So the list was not perfect because it's missing this diagonal number, and that is a logical contradiction. We assumed that we were able to make a perfect list of room assignments, but the list is in fact incomplete. So we must conclude that there was no way to assign the real numbers to rooms in Hotel Infinity. The real numbers have a larger cardinality than the integers. We've now shown that there are two different sizes of infinity, the cardinality of the natural numbers and the cardinality of the real numbers. For level 5, let's show that there are infinitely many cardinalities of infinity. We need one more idea in order to do this, called a power set. Say we have a set that contains an apple and an orange, two fruits in a fridge. This set has cardinality 2, and when we go to the fridge and consider taking some fruit, there are 4 possibilities. We can take no fruit, just the apple, just the orange, or both. These are the 4 subsets of the fruits in the fridge. The set of these 4 possibilities is called the power set. As another example, let's look at the power set of the natural numbers. A subset of the naturals is a selection of some of those values. For example, maybe we pick just the evens, or just the odds. Maybe we pick none of them, or just the number 7. We could take all of them, or we could take all of them except for 23. These are all subsets of the natural numbers. The power set of the naturals is the set of all of these possible subsets. Cantor's theorem tells us that a power set always has a larger cardinality than the original set. We'll prove this in just a minute. In the previous level, we saw 2 infinite cardinalities, the cardinality of the natural numbers and the cardinality of the real numbers. Cantor's theorem gives us another one, the cardinality of the power set of the real numbers. This set must have an even larger cardinality. But now the magic happens. We can get an even higher cardinality by taking the power set of that set. And we can keep taking power sets as many times as we want, and each time we get a higher cardinality. So now we have infinitely many cardinalities of infinity. Let's prove Cantor's theorem. The proof follows a diagonal argument. Say that A is our original set. You can imagine it's the real numbers if you want something concrete to think about. And then P of A is the power set of A. For contradiction, let's assume that these two sets have the same cardinality, which means that there's a bijection between them. So let's call that F. Let's write down an example for the real numbers. The real number 0 will be paired with some subset of the real numbers. Maybe it's all the positive odd integers. The real number pi will also be paired with some other subset of the real numbers. So maybe it's the subset that has pi and 2 pi. Every other real number is paired off with some other subset. This bijection, the function f that establishes these pairs, is supposed to be perfect. Every possible subset should be matched up with some real number. So let's create a subset that's actually missing from the bijection. To create a subset of A, we have to decide whether or not to include each element x in A. To decide, let's see what subset x is paired with. The subset f of x could contain the value x or not. So let's try to be contrary in our construction. F of 0 is the set of positive odd integers. That does not contain 0. So to be contrary, let's include 0 in our subset. F of pi is the subset with pi and 2 pi, which does include pi. So to be contrary, let's not include pi. Symbolically, we're creating a set B made up of all the elements x in A, where x is not in f of x. This notation's a bit abstract, but it's really the same diagonal idea from level 4. Could this subset that we constructed be included in the bijection? Well, let's check our examples. Our subset can't be the one paired with 0, because the one that's paired with 0 does not contain 0, but ours does. We specifically constructed our set to be contrary about that. And our subset can't be the one that's paired with pi, because the one paired with pi contains pi, but ours doesn't. By being contrary, we've made sure that our subset can't be equal to any of the subsets used in the bijection. So f is not really a bijection, and this is a contradiction. There was no possible way to pair off the elements of A with the subsets of the power set. This means that the power set has a greater cardinality than the cardinality of A. And from this, we can find infinitely many cardinalities of infinity. Let us know your thoughts about Hotel Infinity and Cantor's diagonal proof. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.